Welcome to this presentation. I'll be discussing neonatal jaundice, focusing mainly on the approach to the management. So the level that is aimed at is for training pediatricians as well as pediatricians who do neonatology on occasional basis. But as a refresher, it will be useful for anyone and it might be helpful for parents too. The objectives are to understand the pathophysiology of neonatal jaundice. I'll be discussing this in brief. We should be aware of the importance of appropriate monitoring and treatment of neonatal jaundice. We should have a clear idea of postnatal management and the timing of the follow-up so that significant jaundice is not missed. Neonatal jaundice is a very common but important problem during the neonatal period. All of us would have had some patients who have significant levels of jaundice who give us a lot of tension. Delayed diagnosis and management can lead to serious problems like the bilirubin-induced brain damage, and that is what we want to prevent. A structured approach to universal screening for jaundice during the postnatal period is important because we cannot really accept any baby having the brain injury due to bilirubin. Just a quick overview of the bilirubin metabolism. I'll also discuss a little bit about how it plays an important role in neonatal jaundice. So when the hemoglobin breaks down, when the RBCs are killed and the hemoglobin is released, it breaks down into heme and porphyrin components. The heme is the iron-containing part, and heme is acted on by heme oxygenase, and biliverdin is released. Biliverdin is a precursor of bilirubin, and by the action of biliverdin reductase, unconjugated bilirubin is formed. Bilirubin that is released is bound in albumin, and when the albumin is exceeded in the plasma, free bilirubin is circulating, which is a dangerous situation as it can easily cross the blood-brain barrier. The unconjugated bilirubin is then taken up by the liver, where the enzymes UDP glucuronate transferase acts on to cause conjugated bilirubin, which then gets excreted through the bile into the stool. So part of the conjugated bilirubin gets acted on in the intestines and it may get reabsorbed. This may be one of the factors related to breast milk related prolonged jaundice, where this enzyme is active, beta-glucuronidase enzyme is active in the breast milk. So the conjugated bilirubin gets broken down in the stool and it gets absorbed back into the bloodstream. So the jaundice persists. This is a benign type of jaundice. We will discuss that later as well. So for most neonates, hyperbilirubinemia is a benign postnatal transitional phenomenon. However, developmental red blood cell, hepatic and gastrointestinal immaturity results in an imbalance favoring the bilirubin production over clearance. So if you look at this again, normally it's just the senescent RBCs that break down. But as we know, the fetus has a high load of red blood cells because of the hypoxic in utero environment. And when the baby is born, when exposed to the oxygen in the environment, more red cells are destroyed in the reticuloendothelial system. So there is a higher release of this RBC breakdown products in the baby's blood. The baby's liver is immature. This is even more so in the premature babies. So the conjugation process is slower than normal. So more unconjugated bilirubin circulates. So combined with the increased production, this also leads to the increase in jaundice. The babies are born vaginally most of the time, and during the birth process, the babies have bruising in some cases. In the premature babies, this is more significant. Some babies may have cephalhematoma, which is a blood collection in the scalp coverings. All these may lead to, again, more red cell destruction and bilirubin production. As we know, in the first 3 to 4 days, the baby is relatively dehydrated because the breast milk production is on the lower side. So obviously dehydration increases the risk of jaundice as well, because the conjugation process needs energy, and dehydration leads to hemoconcentration, which relatively increases the unconjugated bilirubin in the blood. So what is the incidence of significant hyperbilirubinemia? So when we say hyperbilirubinemia, any increase above normal is taken as hyperbilirubinemia, and we are more worried about a level that has been shown to cause brain injury in babies. Obviously, it can happen at any level, especially if it is hemolytic jaundice, where there is a sudden burst of free bilirubin in the bloodstream, or if there is a condition like birth asphyxia or sepsis which can damage the blood-brain barrier. But in general terms, in well babies, in term babies, we can expect more than 25 milligrams as a level above which the risk of brain injury increases. However, we cannot be ignoring the relatively higher levels that are seen in other babies. So the treatment threshold, as we will discuss later, is aimed to prevent it reaching levels that damage the brain. If we take more than 17 milligram per deciliter or 291 micromoles, so the conversion factor is milligrams times 17.5 to get the micromole reading. That will be 1 in 10. And more than 20 milligrams, which previously about 20 years ago, that used to be the cutoff for exchange transfusion even in term babies. So 1 in 70 babies would have needed. However, nowadays we are waiting more in the well babies, and after the AAP recommendations in 2004 came out, we hardly do exchange at 20 milligrams unless it's hemolytic jaundice or if it's a premature baby. So we have more than 25 milligrams in 1 in 700 babies, and more than 30 is luckily very uncommon, with more than 1 in 10,000. However, we don't see this because we usually treat around this level, 17 to 20 milligrams, if you start noting the increase. As I said earlier, what we are aiming to prevent is bilirubin-induced brain damage. It can present in the acute stage with acute bilirubin encephalopathy. In the early stages, the baby has lethargy, hypotonia, and poor suck. In the intermediate stage, the baby starts getting stuporose, maybe irritable and hypertonic as well. And this is typically at this stage that we get the posturing, the retrocollis and the opisthotonic posturing we get with typical bilirubin-induced brain injury. The baby may have fever due to hypothalamic involvement. High-pitched cry, which can alternate with drowsiness and hypotonia, may be there. So poor feeding is inevitably associated. This compounds a problem. And obviously, you can see that these features are not specific for bilirubin-induced brain damage. It can present many baby with sepsis and meningitis, hypoglycemic brain injury, and so on as well. So this is just a chart which gives us a tabulation form, scoring system for bilirubin-induced brain injury and the features. So we can categorize into mental status, muscle tone, and cry pattern with a score of 0 to 3 for all three. If the mental status is normal, it's a 0 score, sleepy but can be aroused or decreased feeding, 1, and lethargy, poor suck, irritable, etc., 2. Similarly, for muscle tone, normal tone, persistent or mild hypotonia, mild to moderate hypotonia, and a hypertonia alternating, and arching of the neck and opisthotonus may start, and persistent retrocollis and opisthotonus. And in cry pattern, we have the normal cry, high-pitched cry when aroused, if the baby has a shrill and difficult to console type of crying, and then if there is inconsolable crying or weak and absent cry become comatose, it becomes 3. So as you can see here, the scores of 1 to 3 are consistent with subtle signs of acute bilirubin encephalopathy, and scores 4 to 6 indicate moderate bilirubin injury, and scores of 7 to 9 indicates advanced bilirubin injury. So most of these babies with advanced or moderate injury would be going for an acute or emergency exchange transfusion. Kernicterus is nothing but the chronic form of bilirubin encephalopathy. So this bilirubin binding in the brain areas causes permanent brain damage, and it can cause a severe form of athetoid cerebral palsy. We may have hearing problems, auditory dysfunction. It's a sensory neural type of deafness. Dental enamel hypoplasia as the or dysplasia, as the developing teeth buds are sensitive to bilirubin binding as well. Typically, along with the athetoid cerebral palsy, we also have paralysis of the upward gaze, and intellectual handicaps of varying degrees may be seen. Thankfully, kernicterus is not seen that frequently these days due to our aggressive screening and management. It is rare, but still happens. It's more often seen in resource-limited settings where the parents may not be educated adequately or the follow-up system may not be adequate. In many case reports in the early 2000s, there were occurrences even in the United States, and population-based estimates for kernicterus in term babies in the developed countries ranges from 1 in 30,000 to 1 in 200,000 live births. Newborns are being discharged in the hospital sooner than ever before because of insurance pressures. And early discharge means we are less able to observe the newborns for the development of jaundice. So it brings in the importance of proper screening and adequate follow-up. So the goal of management is to reduce or eliminate the occurrence of severe neonatal hyperbilirubinemia and bilirubin encephalopathy. We should decrease unintended harm, however, as increased anxiety may happen if we worry the parents with the levels, decrease breastfeeding because of possible separation, or even phototherapy may inhibit, make the mother more anxious and inhibit milk output. We may unnecessarily treat or make the samples frequently, which results in pain for the baby, and of course, excessive cost and wastage of resources if you don't follow a proper guideline or over-treat. As I said earlier, the AAP came out with a clinical practice guideline, management of hyperbilirubinemia in newborn infants 35 or more weeks of gestation. This came out in 2004 and an update in 2009. In terms of maternal screening, that's mainly to find out whether the baby will be at risk of jaundice. So we have the ABO and RH blood types. The serum screen for unusual isoimmune antibodies should also be done in all pregnant women. If the mother is not screened or is Rh negative, blood group and Coombs test should be done on the infant's blood. If the mother is O positive, there is an option to test the baby's type and the direct antibody test, especially if the baby's blood type is A or B or AB. As the ABO incompatibility is a less severe form of the disease and the Rh incompatibility, this testing can be done if required based on the clinical surveillance. Newborn should be routinely monitored for jaundice, and all nurseries should have established protocols for jaundice management. The protocol should include the condition under which the nurse can obtain a total serum bilirubin or a transcutaneous serum bilirubin level. So a guideline in place where the nurse is empowered, and proper education sessions so they're aware of what they are doing, they can clarify parents' questions and inform the doctors where there is a concern, should all be included in your training package. Provide information for parents at discharge, explaining the significance of jaundice, the need to monitor. It's also important to ensure that the feeding is established adequately at this stage. A bilirubin measurement should be done on any baby less than 24 hours old who is jaundiced or is high risk due to the blood group related factors. The transcutaneous bilirubin should be measured in all babies at 24 hours and then pre-discharge depending on the timing of discharge. If it's a cesarean delivery and the baby is going to stay for 3 days, we can check it every 12 to 24 hours, depending on the previous measurements. The need and timing of another bilirubin test depends on the risk zone into which the bilirubin falls, the age of the infant, and the risk factors. All the bilirubin levels should be interpreted according to the baby's age in hours. Transcutaneous bilirubinometry is a very helpful tool in monitoring babies for bilirubin. This is not going to give you the exact serum bilirubin, but it is an approximation. And in most cases, even in dark skin races, it correlates. In the premature babies, there may be a tendency to overread. So we should take that into account before we order a serum bilirubin. It measures the bilirubin in the extravascular tissue. The transcutaneous bilirubin measurements can tell us whether we should worry about this infant's jaundice, whether we should do a serum bilirubin, and when I should review next for the post-discharge visit. This can be used at follow-up as well, and we find it very helpful. In our clinic, for example, once we see them at the follow-up visit, we guide the parents to come to the nurse's clinic directly, and they only see the physician at follow-up again if it's rising. If the baby is under phototherapy, because the phototherapy is going to reduce the skin cutaneous bilirubin, it's not going to be effective. Patching can be used for a partial reliability, but it's not going to be very reliable. So if the bilirubin was high to start with, you need a serum bilirubin again to confirm the efficacy of phototherapy. Bhutanese charts are one of the premier options we have to monitor the risk zone under which the baby falls. So there is the age on the x-axis and the serum bilirubin on the y-axis. You have both in micromoles and milligrams on either side. It categorizes the babies into low risk zone, low intermediate risk zone, high intermediate risk zone, and the high risk zone. This predicts which baby is going to reach a level needing phototherapy and also guides us on how quickly we should see them at follow-up. We have a tool called Billy Tool, which is based on the American Academy nomogram or phototherapy chart, and it can be accessed on billytool.org. Many units use them currently to guide their jaundice treatment, and as I said earlier, the nurses can be empowered to use this chart, so they don't need to call the doctor if it is not needing treatment. enter the patient's age in hours and the bilirubin value in the unit which is suitable in your unit. Both the options are available for milligram and micromoles. So the BiliTool provides an age-specific risk stratification based on the Bhutanese chart I showed earlier. It gives a suggested action and the follow-up intervals considering the risk factors. And it also gives the phototherapy recommendation, which considers the neurotoxicity risk factors. So this is a screenshot from a baby's entry. So the baby is 45 hours old. Total bilirubin was 12 milligrams per deciliter. So this is on bilitool.org. And it is giving the first reading, which is the categorization of the risk as high intermediate risk. These are the risk factors which we'll be looking at in the next few slides. And it also categorizes the risk zone, lower risk, where it is more than 38 weeks and well baby, medium risk, where the baby is more than 38 weeks with any of these risk factors, or 35 to 37 weeks with no risk factors, and higher risk where the baby is 35 to 37 weeks and having risk factors as well. So your action depends on the risk group. If the baby falls in a lower risk, follow up within 48 hours. If medium risk, you consider phototherapy and you have to recheck within 24 hours if you don't start phototherapy, and higher risk, you would consider phototherapy as well. So moving on to the next part of the BiliTool readings, it gives us the phototherapy recommendation. And here we also have the neurotoxicity risk factors to the side, which will guide us. So basically anything that increases the free bilirubin in the blood or affects the blood-brain barrier. So you have isoimmune hemolytic disease, G6PD deficiency, birth asphyxia, significant lethargy, temperature instability, sepsis, acidosis, and the low serum albumin. Remember that in a premature baby, the albumin may be low as well. And a sick baby usually tends to have acidosis and temperature instability. So all these may affect, and hypoglycemia may affect as well. So we should keep in mind that we should be monitoring the risk of this along with the categorization here. So in the case we discussed, 45 hours of age with 12 milligrams, if the baby was 35 to 37 weeks and had neurotoxicity risk factors, you would start phototherapy at 11 milligrams. And if the baby was more mature or 37 weeks, you would start at 12.8 milligrams. And if no risk factors, at 14.9. So this is a guide again. And just to reiterate that it is an option to provide conventional phototherapy in the hospital or at home at bilirubin levels 2 to 3 milligrams below those shown, or 35 to 50 micromoles per liter. So sometimes depending on the family situation, and remember that if you don't treat, you have to keep bringing them back. So you have the option to admit them and treat pending the insurance coverage and the parents' desire to treat. So the major risk factors are total bilirubin or transcutaneous bilirubin in the high-risk zone, jaundice within the first 24 hours, because mostly it's a pathologic cause of jaundice. However, with delayed cord clamping these days, some jaundice may be seen in the first 24 hours. You don't need to act differently if the trend of increase is not too bad. The blood group incompatibility with positive direct antiglobulin test or other known hemolytic disease, gestational age of 35 to 36 weeks, previous sibling receiving phototherapy, cephalomatoma or significant bruising, exclusive breastfeeding, particularly if nursing is not going well and the weight loss is excessive. This is more important in the primary gravida mothers. And East Asian race has been shown to have a higher risk of jaundice, possibly due to liver maturity factors. Minor risk factors where the bilirubin falls in the high intermediate risk zone and the gestation is 37 to 38 weeks, jaundice observed before discharge, previous sibling with jaundice but not needing treatment, macrosomic infant of diabetic mother, and maternal age greater than or equal to 25 years and male gender. These pointers indicate low risk where we don't need to be that worried, and the follow-up can be delayed as well if needed. So the bilirubin in the low risk zone, gestational age equal to or greater than 41 weeks, exclusive bottle feeding, black race, discharge from the hospital after 72 hours of age, where mostly baby would have come into this category, or if needing treatment, you would have treated already. So regarding the timing of follow-up, it's important to ensure appropriate timing based on the factors we discussed. If there is a public holiday coming up, you should have that factored in as well, both in the discharge plan as well as in the follow-up plan. And also the appropriate feeding advice should be given before we discharge the baby. The assessment at follow-up should include the baby's naked weight and the percent change from birth. adequacy of intake, pattern avoiding and stooling, and jaundice assessment. If the mother is starting to feed well, we should give her signs of improved milk output, like increasing urine output, baby satiety, and so on. And we should have an alternative option to advise her if there are signs that the baby is not getting enough milk. So earlier follow-up can be advised in those instances, or the mother can come before the scheduled appointment. We should also be aware that poor feeding can lead to hypernatremia, which can be causing brain injury as well. So feeding, jaundice monitoring, and appropriate weight gain monitoring are important. We should request the serum bilirubin if the transcutaneous bilirubin is over 220 to 240 micromoles, 12.5 to 14 milligrams per cent. This is because this is a rough guide. It's not the exact indicator, and the bilirubin result can be plus or minus 2 to 3 milligrams above the reading on the transcutaneous. So if it is above the level, it may fall in the treatment zone. We should ensure adequate hydration and support feeding. We should plot the bilirubin on our specific nomograms. Phototherapy is a mainstay of treatment if the baby falls in the treatment level, and I discussed the criteria for deciding on the treatment. Unconjugated bilirubin absorbs the light most strongly in the blue region of the spectrum, which is near 460 nanometers. The direct bilirubin, the direct relationship is there between efficacy of phototherapy and irradiance. So the age of the bulbs that are used, the height at which it is kept, the number of lamps that are used, possibly increase the surface area by using a billy bed, or you can use a billy blanket. So this is the American Academy phototherapy chart, which gives us three lines based on the risk. So infants at lower risk, infants at medium risk, and the infants at the highest risks, and the treatment cutoffs are obviously different. It's also different up to your age of 72 hours or so, after which it's a plateau. And in premature babies, we have to remember that they have a higher risk of jaundice due to the factors we discussed earlier. The treatment threshold should be based on the gestation. One useful reference for the preterm babies is the NICE UK charts, where you get gestation-specific guidelines, and this is a link for that. If the baby has severe IUGR, I would suggest using a chart for a lower gestation age. In my unit, we follow if a baby is, say, 1 kilo at 30 weeks of gestation, the 1 kilo is average weight around 27, 28 weeks. In that case, we follow a 27 or 28 week chart. As the baby becomes older, by every week, we can progress with the chart as well. So if the jaundice continues and baby is 10 days old, we can go on to 1 week older chart. If a very high level of jaundice, the lipid content in the TPN will need reducing to 2 grams per kilo per day till the jaundice starts to improve. However, this should be a transient response, and we should remember that lipid is important for nutrition, so don't keep it low for a long time. Very aggressive phototherapy in the extreme low birth weight babies can be harmful, and some studies have shown increased mortality, possibly due to increased risk of infection. And this could be related to the antioxidant effect of bilirubin, which could have a protective effect in the lower levels of jaundice. This is a screenshot of the NICE phototherapy chart at 26 weeks gestation. So if you go to the link I had attached, you have the different charts you can download. So you enter the gestation here and the chart will come appropriate. So you have both for phototherapy and for exchange transfusion. What is the lab workup we need? That will depend on the severity of the jaundice. So we need the serum bilirubin before you start phototherapy, additional lab tests, hemoglobin, hematocrit, blood group, direct antibody test, reticulocyte count to see the extent of hemolysis, and G6PD should be added if there is unexplained hemolysis. Where there is a family history, you can assume till the results are pending. And again, we should remember that in some places, a newborn screen includes G6PD deficiency. So you may as well send the newborn screen and wait for the result, as it wouldn't change your treatment. In terms of conjugated jaundice, if the baby is sick, especially if the premature baby has been on TPN or has infection, or the babies were jaundiced at 3 weeks of age or later, we should have a total and direct bilirubin measured to identify cholestasis. We should also have the newborn's thyroid and galactosemia screen results verified either through the newborn screen or testing separately. We should remember that we should not miss any case of biliary atresia diagnosis. So that's the reason we want to do the prolonged jaundice screen at 3 weeks of age. 2 to 3 weeks, but majority of the time, if you have been monitoring the jaundice in the beginning, 3 weeks is a reasonable time. Infants with an elevated direct or conjugated bilirubin should also have urine analysis and culture. If the direct bilirubin is high, look for the cause of cholestasis, so you may need to do further tests, including ultrasound to review the gallbladder and the liver, as well as other metabolic tests. The newborn screen result gives us valuable information here as well. If there is further abnormality, obviously you would need to refer to a pediatric gastroenterologist. What are the criteria for admission to the NICU? So obviously this would depend on your setup. Most of the units nowadays use phototherapy in the ward, postnatal ward, where the mother and baby are together. Intensive phototherapy, sometimes the baby needs to be admitted to the NICU in some settings. However, a definite indication for admission in the NICU would be signs of acute bilirubin encephalopathy. If the bilirubin is either at or more than the exchange level, and sepsis or ill-appearing child. You discuss with the neonatologist where the bilirubin level is above the exchange level to discuss appropriate blood products for arranging exchange transfusion. We have to keep this ready because it takes time for the blood bank to arrange, and it takes 4 to 6 hours. So even if you feel with the phototherapy it will reduce, you still have to make the arrangement. If the bilirubin level is remaining above the exchange level after 4 hours of intensive phototherapy, so we obviously have to involve the neonatologist for exchange. If the gestational age at birth is less than 35 weeks, baby is at high risk of progressing, and it's also more difficult to handle. Patients with immune-mediated hemolysis for either RH or ABO setting, where it is rising to either at or above the exchange level, there is enough evidence to show that IV immunoglobulin treatment may reduce the need for exchange transfusion by dropping the rate of increase. It works by blocking off the FC sites, swamping the system basically. And you will still need to continue phototherapy and monitor closely. So majority of the time, if there is immune hemolysis, we may prevent by using IVIG. Exchange transfusion can be prevented. The infants undergoing conventional phototherapy should not be routinely supplemented with IV fluids or formula. Breast milk is, of course, the feed of choice, and we should be careful not to implicate breastfeeding in the jaundice. So even if you want formula supplement, we should clearly educate the family that it is a temporary measure as an addition to supported breastfeeding. And we should also try to increase our mother's breast milk output and supplement the baby with express milk. Since it will be for a short term, we should use avoid bottle feeding. We should supplement with syringe or cup feeding. Lactation support should be given for every inpatient admission where the baby has jaundice and the mother is breastfeeding. Supplementary IV fluid should be given where the baby is clinically dehydrated, especially if the sodium is significantly high. We should be monitoring carefully, and it shouldn't drop rapidly. Where we have a total serum bilirubin approaching the exchange transfusion or above the level, IV fluids may help, but it's not essential to use it depending on the unit decision. Exchange transfusion is considered where intensive phototherapy is initiated and the repeat after 4 hours still shows the level to be high, or if the baby has any signs of bilirubin encephalopathy, neurological problems, we should be doing exchange transfusion aggressively. Should also be aggressive in premature babies because the serum albumin may be low and the blood-brain barrier is immature. If the bilirubin is reducing well, we could avoid exchange transfusion, and we discussed IVIG in isoimmunization settings as well. Immediate exchange is recommended in any jaundice baby who shows the signs of intermediate advanced stages, even if the bilirubin is falling. So this is the exchange chart from the American Academy, and most of the exchange guidelines are based on consensus recommendations. And if it is showing a declining trend and the baby is neurologically normal, you can wait and observe a little more before you perform, because exchange transfusion has significant impact on the baby both in the short and long term. Regarding the follow-up, after the phototherapy, we can repeat the bilirubin 12 hourly till it falls to 20% below the treatment level. We should discharge if stable and follow up in 36 to 48 hours. Obviously, if the bilirubin was purely the treatment was purely for physiologic exaggerated jaundice and we don't have much risk factors, the repeat blood test is optional if the transcutaneous bilirubin under a patch is reducing well. But this again is practice and you follow your unit guidelines. The repeat testing for rebound rise is not necessary, so we usually discharge the baby soon after we stop phototherapy. Parents obviously prefer home management. Repeat bilirubin 4 to 6 hours after starting phototherapy if level is close to exchange level. So it's important to repeat the blood test in these cases. Outcome is good unless there are clinical features of encephalopathy, in which case MRI is indicated with close neurodevelopmental follow-up. The discovery of phototherapy was itself based on the effect of sunlight on jaundice. And even though we know that sunlight is not going to be anywhere near as effective as phototherapy, there may be some benefit. But if you do suggest, or if the parents do want to show sunlight, the factor, it's very important to warn them that sunlight doesn't do much. If the baby has a significant level of jaundice, especially if it's a level that's approaching brain injury, we should review the baby and consider phototherapy if it is at a significant level. So sunlight is not an alternative to proper clinical monitoring and management. And it's also important to advise the parents that going out in the sun may dehydrate the baby. Vitamin D needs direct sunlight exposure, while for jaundice, even light through the window, UV filtration doesn't affect, because it's light in the visible length that affects on the skin, and baby needs to be open for a period of time. You can't keep the baby open for a long time due to risk of hypothermia at home. So all these factors have to be explained if at all the parents want to expose to sunlight. So this is a well ingrained community practice. So rather than bluntly discouraging its use, we can explain the pros and cons, say that it's not going to be effective, but even if you do it in a safe way, and that's not a substitute for need for monitoring and follow-up. To conclude, neonatal jaundice is a common but very important problem. All the pediatricians as well as the family should be aware of the risk factors and importance of early identification and treatment if there is a significant rise. Transcutaneous bilirubinometry is a valuable tool and should be available in any clinic or hospital who deals with neonates and follow-up. So thank you for your patient listening. If you have any questions, we would be discussing it separately. Thank you.